we are so glad that you have joined Pleasant Hill United Methodist Church for the Sunday service, August 14th. We hope that your time with us blesses you and draws you closer to God and closer to those around you. Unite our voices as we proclaim the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Boys and girls, this is a special day because it's God's Day, and we always say that Sundays are special because they're God's Day, but it's also special at Pleasant Hill this week because it's Promotion Sunday. Now that's a day that we celebrate all the boys and girls at the church and all the members of the church, but we especially recognize those sixth graders who are moving up into the youth and those third graders who receive their Bibles as they move up into third grade. So today, we are recognizing sixth graders, and their names are Reese Douglas, Fisher Parsons, K- Kennedy Rawls, Sarah Kate Stallworth, and Hudson Walker. And we celebrate them and look forward to their days ahead because they are on an adventure with God as they continue in their life. The third graders we'll be recognizing today are Anna Kate Owens, Matthew Cook, and Baylor Stacy. And we present the third graders with very special Bibles. They are called an adventure Bible because it talks about their adventure with God. It's God's word, but it's printed in a way that is very special for children. And third graders can begin to read their Bibles for themselves. And so as they read and look at this Bible, there are pictures that tell about Bible times. And there are also treasure boxes that show very special Bible verses. And one treasure box contains my very favorite Bible verse. It's John 3:16. Let's read that together. It says, "Words to treasure. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." That is a wonderful Bible verse. And today, I want you to think just for a minute. Let's go back and think about what Miss Vonette told y'all when she was talking about things that we believe, because I believe this Bible verse. But she talked about your backpacks last week. Do you remember that she said your backpack could remind you of things you believe? That the handle reminds us that God can handle anything. That the straps on your backpack remind you that God has your back and he can handle anything that comes your way. She talked about the zippers, that the zipper securely held things, and God will be there to securely uphold you. She talked about how the part in your backpack will remind you that nothing is large enough to hold all the love that God has for you. So she talked about the things that you believe. Now today, why don't we just look at this Bible verse and think about the things that we believe. We're going to do the same thing with this Bible verse. I'm looking at this Bible verse. What does it begin with? Who is mentioned in this Bible verse first? It says, "For God so loved the world." God loved the world. Father God. I believe in God the Father. Do you believe in God the Father? Let's say that together. Let's say, "I believe in God the Father." I believe in God the Father. Let's look again at this verse. God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son. Who was his own one and only Son? What was his name? His name was Jesus Christ. I believe in Jesus Christ. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Let's say it together. I believe in Jesus Christ. And the last part is sometimes my very favorite because it says, "Whosoever believes in him," who would that be? Who believes in Jesus Christ? You just said you believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in Jesus Christ. So this is talking about us. "Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." This is God's promise to you, that you believe in him and that you will have eternal life. I believe in eternal life. Do you believe in eternal life? I believe in eternal life. This is wonderful. This is John 3:16, and it is really a verse to treasure. Now, I believe that God will go with every one of these children we've mentioned all through their life. I believe that God will be with every one of those youth, no matter what their adventure is, all through their life. And I believe that God will go with you because God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son to you. I believe in that. I believe God loves you, everyone. Will y'all say a prayer with me? Bow your heads and close your eyes. And let's say, "Father God, we believe in you. We know that you will be with these children. We know that you will be with these youth. We know that you will be with us as adults. And we will know that you will be with you through eternity, for everlasting life. We love you. Amen." Y'all know that God goes with you this week, that you can believe in him because he loves you so much. Y'all have a great week.
As a church that faithfully prays, It is such a blessing to know that our God hears and answers our prayers. We know that as we lift concerns to God, God will bring about answers in His time and in His way. We also have so much to praise God about. As we go to prayer, remember the names of those on our prayer list. Remember those concerns that you have. Please feel free to share them in the comments below or call the church office or one of the pastors. It's a privilege to pray with and for you. Also, share with us the ways God is answering prayer in your lives. We like hearing praise notes. Please join me as we lift our voices to God. Loving God, we adore you. You are high and lifted up above all others and above all names. You put our world into being, and you loved us and have drawn us to you with that love. We thank you for Jesus, who you gave to be our Savior. We thank you for his life and the lessons and examples he gave. We thank you for his death and his resurrection, which bring us forgiveness and salvation. Lord, we ask that you be with our nation. Be with our leaders. Guide them in the ways of justice and truth. Put a hedge of protection around our law enforcement, our first responders, and our military. Lord, where we are facing disasters in our world, be they natural or man-caused, we ask that you be with all of those who are facing the effects of whatever is happening in their world. Bring peace and hope and great love to each and every situation. We ask, God, that you be with our church. Continue to inspire us by your Holy Spirit in the ways that we can serve you by serving those in our community and world. Fill our church with a fresh inblowing of your Holy Spirit. Kindle our flames of love and service. Help us to do all that we can to present your image and love in our world. God, we thank you so much that you do hear and answer our prayers. And as I lift to you the words here, we ask that you hear also the cries of those who are praying with us. God, we ask in the name of Jesus that your healing and wholeness and comfort and peace flow through all of those who were ill or who were in distress in any way. Please guide caregivers and medical teams to proper solutions. We ask that you comfort the caregivers, strengthen them, and be with all the patients so that they can know and rest in your abiding presence. We ask, God, that you be with everyone who mourns. Please shelter them under your wing and pour into their lives peace and a comfort that surpasses all human explanation. Remind them also that you are always with them and they are never alone. God, we have questions and we have concerns that we can't even voice. Sometimes we don't want to voice, and we know that you are aware of each thing that weighs on our hearts. We ask that you be in each situation. Send forth laborers to work as you direct to help all those who need to know you come to a saving knowledge of your Son, Jesus. We ask that people turn to you as the source of all of their needs. And we ask that you, the great peace giver, fill the people with a peace that helps them to move forward according to your direction. Please forgive us for the ways that we have fallen short of your will, and the ways that we have broken your law. Help us to move forward as forgiven people, ready to draw you closer into our lives and to draw others into a knowledge of you by sharing our gifts and talents and by spending time with those who need to know you. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who has taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O Thou of God and the Son, Thee will I cherish, Thee will I honor, Thee my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Jesus, walk with me.
So this morning, we continue our series of sermons based on the Apostles' Creed. And today, we'll focus on that second part. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the first chapter of John, the first verse. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and without Him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in Him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. He was in the world, and the world came into being through Him, yet the world did not know Him. He came to what was His own, and His own people did not accept Him. But to all who received Him, who believed in His name, He gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Shall we pray? Speak to us, O God, and we will listen. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. So last week, we talked about our belief in this Almighty God, this Creator of heaven and earth, who in an all-powerful love creates this world in such a beautiful way that everything is interconnected and every aspect of creation points back toward the one who created it. And we as human beings, created in the very image of God, meaning created with the ability to love as God loves. And how God takes that perfect, beautiful creation and places it in the hands of human beings who bear His very likeness to care for the creation as God would care for that creation, to love creation and one another as God loves this creation and one another. And we talked about our regret. We talked about the remorse we feel as we look at what we have done to God's creation and what we have done to one another. you know, it's so beautifully illustrated in the second chapter of Genesis, the story of Adam and Eve who work alongside each other in that beautiful, perfect garden where God gives them everything in that garden for their pleasure, for their joy. That God gives them this unmatched feeling of meaning and purpose and significance. And all God asks is that they refrain from eating from one tree. They can have all the trees, but to refrain from eating from this one tree of the knowledge of good and evil. In other words, to refrain from evil. To refrain from dwelling in sin. And he tells them that the moment you eat of that tree, you will surely die. I don't know what it is about human beings. Sometimes not being able to control our sense of curiosity. And I don't imagine it took the serpent very much persuasion as Adam and Eve stand before that tree and the serpent begins asking them questions of why they can't eat from this tree and the serpent telling them, oh, you won't die if you eat from this tree. God knows that if you eat from this tree, you will become just like him. Oh, how good that must have sounded. The thought of becoming God. The thought of being able to take creation and have it on our own terms to do with as we please, to do with as we choose. We don't need God. That is the original sin. And I guess the serpent was right. You know, Adam and Eve, they don't begin to, you know, physically die immediately. But they begin to die spiritually. They lose that sense of pleasure. They lose the sense of joy. They lose the sense of meaning and significance and purpose. We see the result of that original sin just as it originally took place in our world today. Immediately, they begin to turn against one another. Immediately, they begin to turn against the creation. Immediately, they begin to turn against God, and their hearts are filled with fear. You know, I think all the brokenness of this world is a result of fear. And suddenly, the ground of that garden that had proved so fruitful, the purpose in that garden which had filled them with significance and meaning, well, it's replaced with thorns and thistles, pointless labor, and the sweat of their brow. From that point forward, what we refer to as the original sin, well, the image of God in which this world was created, the image of God in which you and I were created, it seemed as though it had all but disappeared. And this loving, all-powerful God, it tells us in the time of Noah that this loving, all-powerful God looks upon the creation in which he had created and is filled with a sense of regret for ever having created it at all. no matter how God reaches out, no matter how many times God seeks to save humanity and this creation, as the writer of John would say, we tended to choose darkness over light. We tended to choose death over life. Somewhere along the way, you remember God encounters this man by the name of Abraham. And he makes Abraham, remember old Abraham, fatherless Abraham, he makes him a promise that one day his descendants are going to outnumber the stars in the sky and the grains of sand on the sea. He promises him that he is going to give him a son. And as the centuries pass, as millennium pass, it seems as though that is going to be an impossible promise to keep. For the world becomes more evil. The world becomes more sinful. The world becomes more dead and dark. Now, in any other religion, in any other mythological story, this would be where the God of creation checks out. The God of creation either destroys the created order, or the God of creation turns his back completely and forgets that created order altogether. Ah. And that brings us to our profession today. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come. He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Ah. You know, it's a beautiful thing that Jesus Christ is that one aspect that separates us from every other world religion. Think about it. In every other world religion, the way to salvation is found by getting it right, by a strict adherence to the law in which you never break, by a strict adherence to a teaching in which you never fail to follow, by this strict adherence of action and doing. And when you finally get it right, then you find your salvation. When you finally get it right, you are freed from the darkness and you are freed from death. That's the basic tenet of every religion in the world. And yet, Christianity says, you will never get it right. You can't get it right. You will never find your way to salvation on your own. You will never be freed from darkness and death on your own. You will never get it right. So God, through his Son Jesus Christ, gets it right for us. Every word in our profession of our belief in Jesus Christ is absolutely important and absolutely necessary for salvation and the recreation and restoration of this beautiful world and the beautiful people that live within. Where most gods in most religions would have either turned their backs or checked out. This almighty God, Father of all creation. No. He finds a way to redeem, and he finds a way to save. Now, going back to that original story, that fall of Adam and Eve, if you read in that second chapter of Genesis, it says that after their fall, and they are aware that they are naked, they are aware that they are sinful and they are evil, that God makes for them clothes of animal skins, meaning that somewhere a sacrifice was made for their sin. A sacrifice was made to make things right. And for thousands of years, that practice of sacrifice for sin was kept and adhered to. But there's a problem with sacrificing a dove or sacrificing a lamb or sacrificing anything else for my sins. How can that atone for my sins? How can the sacrifice of part of the created order atone for the sins of humanity? It wasn't the created order that broke it. It was human beings created in the image of God. So in a sense, you could say God can't fix it because God had placed that law of nature. Once you break, once you sin, you will begin to die. Human beings can't fix it because a sacrifice has to be perfect and blameless and sinless. And there is no human being that fits the bill. God can't fix it. Human beings can't fix it. So this God of all creation, this almighty God, steps out of infinity and steps into the finiteness of a virgin's womb, conceived by the Holy Spirit, completely God and at the same time completely human. Steps into the finiteness of human flesh and blood and bone. What an all-powerful, what an all-loving God. And this God walks in flesh and blood and bone and suffers among us and suffers with us. And the God of all creation stands before the people in a trial of Pontius Pilate's ordering, and when Pontius Pilate, in a sense, says, choose between God and choose between continuing death, the people chose death. And God, wrapped in flesh, the form of Jesus Christ, finally makes things right as he becomes the sacrifice for our sins. Ah. Ah. Thanks be to God. As John says, and the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. Ah. And only an all-powerful and only an all-loving God could once again speak the Word and once again recreate a lifeless, dead body as he is raised from the dead on that third day, conquering sin, conquering death, redeeming the creation, and redeeming those who bear his image, you and I. Thanks be to God. So now we are not judged. Now we are not condemned. For we are judged through the lens of Jesus Christ, who has paid the penalty for our sins. As John says in the third chapter, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Wow. An all-powerful, all-loving God creates the world, and when the world turns its back on this all-powerful, all-loving God, this all-powerful, all-loving God loves this world too much to watch it die. So this all-loving, all-powerful God redeems the world through Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ will not only redeem this world, but Jesus Christ will one day recreate and restore this world into the perfect, beautiful order in which it was created. That is a belief I have based my life on. And it's the only hope I believe this world will ever have. So join with me as we profess together this ancient creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I believe.